Start.
Please start.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the organizing committee, I extend a warm welcome to one and all. Today's webinar, titled Impact of COVID-19 on Teaching Learning Environment, focuses on a theme of immense contemporary relevance. As academicians and principal stakeholders of the teaching learning process, we must adapt ourselves to the new ways of dissemination of knowledge imposed by the outbreak of the pandemic. It is undeniable that tools of information and technology will have a major role in this context. This afternoon, we sit in earnest anticipation to analyze, understand, and embrace this new normal in our education sector. Now, I have the pleasure to request Dr. Amitabh Bosu, Principal Banwarilal Bhalotia College and patron of today's webinar, to deliver the welcome address. Over to sir, please.
Sir,
over to principal, sir, please.
Principal, sir. Yes. Amitabh, sir. Amitabh Basu, sir. Sir. I'm unmute, Kochi. Kindly turn on your video, sir, please. Hello, sir. Abhijit da, kindly dekhun.
Principal sir is not present.
Yes, sir present, but maybe. Devil.
Much question. Aaja.
Sir, mute kore. Principal sir. Did they call current sir? Any problem? Sir. Sir. Hello, Uddulak sir.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, but principal sir, maybe some technical problem. So, please call him.
I am calling. I am calling him. I am calling him.
Okay.
Uddulak.
Haan, bolo. Haan, sir, amar hoye geche.
Hello.
Hello, principal sir.
Sir, present dekhte?
Sir, present achen, sir. Sir, video ebong audio dutoi off ache.
Hello. I want to join the meeting.
অভিজিৎ ফোনে পাচ্ছেন? অভিজিৎ স্যার
করেছি, ফোন করেছি।
ওকে
তো তোমার ওই
যদি কম্পিউটার প্রবলেম হয় কাইন্ডলি মোবাইলে জয়েন করতে হবে।
হ্যালো
হ্যালো, হ্যালো,
ইয়েস,
আই ওয়ান্ট টু জয়েন।
ইউ অলরেডি জয়েন, ইউ অলরেডি জয়েন ম্যাম, প্লিজ মিউট মিউট ইয়োরসেলফ।
হ্যালো,
আই রিকোয়েস্ট অল পার্টিসিপেন্ট প্লিজ মিউট ইউর সেলফ। অভিজিৎ প্লিজ ওয়েট। বুদুল্লাহ স্যার আপনি কিছু বলুন এই এই সময়টা।
ঠিক আছে, আপনি একটু দেখুন NAC.HEC যেটা আছে না, NAC.HEEC। হ্যাঁ এই তো স্যার, স্যার এসেছেন দেখুন। এই তো স্যার।
ওকে স্যার। হ্যালো স্যার।
হ্যালো, আমি অ্যাকচুয়ালি আবার মোবাইল মোবাইল।
ওকে স্যার, you are audible, please turn on your video.
Audible, I'm audible.
Yes, yes, you are.
Yes sir,
yes, you are audible.
Please turn on, please turn on your video.
Turn on.
Hello, hello.
Sir, please start with your welcome.
Thank you very much. I am extremely sorry for disruption. Actually, I sir, again log in through my mobile.
Sir, please rotate your screen. Your okay.
Good afternoon. I extend a warm welcome to our distinguished speakers. We are really honored to have with us the eminent academician as invited speaker in our one day national webinar. Dr. Bulu Maharana, head of the department, and professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Sambalpur University, Sambalpur, Odisha. Dr. Nimai Chand Saha, librarian, Vishwa Bharati, West Bengal.
Continue.
I also Dr. Partho, hello, Dr. Partho Sarathi Mukhopadhyay, head of the department and professor, Department of Library and Information Science, Kalyani University, Kalyani, West Bengal. I also cordially welcome my esteemed colleagues, participants, and dear students to today's webinar titled Impact on COVID-19 on Teaching Learning Environment, organized by our Web Monitoring Committee. Organized by our internal quality assurance cell. We are really overwhelmed by the response of our participants. We have about 1590 participants registered in our today's webinar in the on different parts of the world. The present situation, as one would say in the words of the poet, embodies nothing but the weariness, the fever, and the fright. COVID-19 has indeed plunged the world into a deep abyss of disease and death. The world of academia which mostly relied on physical classroom training, is challenged by the norms of social distancing as necessary enforcement during the trying times. It is imperative that we reconsider our tested methods of imparting education to embrace the new normal by resorting to alternative, mostly web-based pedagogic tools. We now look forward to our eminent speakers to enlighten us how to fight the pandemic in the context of academia by continuing smoothly the intellectual exercises. With these few words, I again want to thank our invited speakers, participants, and the members of all the organizing committee for taking such an initiative. And I wish a grand success of today's webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words of inspiration. Our first resource person for the day, Dr. Bulu Maharana, is professor and head of the postgraduate department of Library and Information Science, Sambalpur University, Sambalpur, Orissa. Sir has been a prolific researcher, presenting many research papers and publishing widely in various international and national journals of repute. Professor Maharana has supervised numerous MPhil and PhD research work on library and information science, acted as resource person on different national and state level workshops and seminars. Besides his academic assignments, Professor Maharana is deputy director of UGC HRDC, Sambalpur University. He is member and chairperson of various boards and committees of Sambalpur University and member of boards of studies of various Indian universities. Sir has been interviewer on different boards for appointment of teachers. Professor Maharana's area of interest is information technology, library automation, and information storage and retrieval. Today, Sir will speak on open access and scholarly communication implications in COVID-19 environment. Now, before we proceed further, I remind all participants that they may send in relevant questions mentioning the name of the speaker by typing into the chat box of our interface. Kindly do not send greeting messages. A question and answer session will be conducted at the end of the third lecture, taking selections of questions sent in by you. Now I have the pleasure to invite Professor Maharana to begin his address. Sir, if you could please start.
Am I audible and visible also?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Okay. Abhijita, you send me PPT, sir, or?
Yeah.
Abhijit, sir?
Abhijit,
sir?
Good afternoon. At the outset, I must thank all the organizers of this national seminar from BB College Asanshol, particularly the principal of the college, the director IQSE, the librarian Mr. Abhijit, and Sujan, and all other people who are involved in this particular seminar, organizing the seminar. The topic you have chosen for this webinar, because there are series of webinars going on, and it has become a new normal for every one of us. And I must congratulate the college to have hosted this webinar in this particular time when we need one. So as my topic is open access and scholarly communication, its implications in COVID-19 environment. All of you, you know that open access has been there for last two decades or so. It started in 2000, in the beginning of the 21st century, and it has been there with us all through. But probably we have not realized, the importance of the term open access and the content and the stuff there in open access. Because our libraries were open, our bookstores were open, and all those stocks in physical format were accessible to us. Now, when this pandemic, which has created complete disruption of the human life in all spheres, has created this situation, and thereafter, every one of us, may he be a teacher, may he be a research scholar, may he be an administrator, may he be a student or any walk of life, they are realizing the disruptions in their field without having access to the material, the information, the books, the journals they wanted to actually access to. So therefore, this concept has become very, very important in this particular environment where we are now experiencing. As we proceed, I will proceed with a famous quote by George Bernard Shaw, who is a Nobel laureate and an Oscar winner. He has quoted that if you have an apple and I have an apple and we exchange these apples, then you and I will still each have one apple. But if you have an idea and I have an idea and we exchange these ideas, then each of us will have two ideas each. So this quotation is implying that how much we need the information, which is the knowledge, the information, the research which have already been there, because the future course of research depends upon what has already been there. If you see this one, this slide, if I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of the giants, the famous scientist Sir Isaac Newton has told this. Because if you have been thinking of something that is not out of nothing, it is based on the things which have already been there, which have already been thought of, which have already been imagined, researched, published. So if you have been able to do something in our field, then we are following the path of our ancestors. Then how do you following the paths of your ancestors? The footprints are available in the recorded research outputs in the form of research articles, in the form of in various mediums they are available, and we follow, and then we actually take the research further. This is what knowledge is. A famous sloka in Sanskrit says, "Na chora harya na cha raja haryana ratru bhajya na cha varakari te krute vardhate eva nityam vidyadhanam sarvadhanam pradhanam." So knowledge, if you share, it multiplies. That is what it says. So what do you have? If you have information, if you have knowledge, then it has to be shared. It has to reach the people who are actually looking forward to that and to work upon that and to carry forward the knowledge further. And traditionally, the knowledge that we have created was under lock and key. Because the publishers to whom actually we were traditionally been giving our research output for publication are toll-gated access. We're having toll-gated access. So that created a problem for institutions, for countries, and for those brilliant scholars actually who are not able to pay for and to break the lock to access to those valuable research. Therefore, realizing this, actually sometime in the past, somebody raised a question that what is the point in doing research if it is not shared? What is the point doing in research if it is not shared? So it has to be shared, because if you have done some research, then it has to reach to the people who are already in working in that area, so that that will help them to go forward with that. And to, if that research has already been done, then they can actually avoid that duplication of the research. So it is very valuable. So therefore, people thought that the information, and particularly the research information, has to be open access. Open access meaning that the things should be freely available. That to be freely available. Okay, can you go forward with that slides, please? The philosophy of open access. Few slides ahead, probably. The philosophy of open access. Next slide, probably. Next slide, please. Maybe the next one. Yeah. This one. The philosophy of open access, which said that the literature is freely available on the public internet, permitting any users to read, download, copy, distribute, print, search, or link to the full text of these articles, crawl them for indexing, pass them as data to software, or use them for any other lawful purposes without financial, legal, or technical barriers other than those inseparable from gaining access to the internet itself. So this definition makes it very clear that if you want to make value addition to the research which is already there, then it has to be open access. It should not be in the lock and key, just in terms of the paying models for that. So there are many institutions, many individual scholars, scientists, at their individual capacity, they're not able to afford to pay for the toll-gated resources. So therefore, this movement was started in the earlier part of the 21st century, as you can actually, the slides are jumbled across. You can go ahead with the, go a little bit backward, please. Backward with the slides. Yes. The next one.
This.
No. This one. So as you can see that usually we can see that two kinds of open access models of scholarly communication. What do you mean by scholarly communication? We all know that as a scholar, as a researcher, as an academician, as a teacher, as a professor, we are engaged in activities where we need to write papers, research papers, theses, and various other such mediums of recorded knowledge, which we need to communicate to our peers, to our students, to the community, and our research network.
Please mute, sir. Don't unmute, because I am sharing screen. Mohanana, sir, continue.
So a very little part of the whole scholarly communication process, which we have can divide it to. There are some which are public, there are some communication stuffs which are private, there are some which are evaluated, and there are many which are not evaluated. But here we are talking about those which are public as well as evaluated, sources of scholarly writings. Here you can see there are two open locks are there, and the colleagues of from the Library Information Science must be aware of that we have the two vehicles of open access. One is the green open access and the gold open access. And the gold open access, the next slide, the gold open access talks about the open access journals. There are many of them are there, and nowadays you can find, if you search in internet, you search for a term, you will find a couple of journals in open access journals. You will find the directory of open access journals, the most referred source of open access journals are there. And the open access journals, which are freely available to the end users, is known as the gold open access. It is usually supported by the organizations or funded by the funding agencies, the article processing charges are charged from the authors. It's known as an author pay model. If you want to publish in a gold publication, gold journal or open access journal, then the individual author has to pay so that the rest of the users will not be paying for it. Then the second model is green open access. Green open access is a model of publishing where there are non-commercial rights to self-archive of the author's articles, author's papers. The archives may be institutional repositories or discipline-specific archives. For example, nowadays every institution, academic institutions, all the IITs, IIMs, NITs, and all big institutions, now they are showcasing their research through their institutional digital archives. And the researchers who are publishing papers, the author's version of the paper is archived into the institutional depositories. This is known as a green public, open access model. This is also known as a subversive model of publication. We had a traditional model of publication. Then we had a substitutory or a parallel publication along with the print and the electronic. And finally, we reached to the subversive model where the self-archive his own article into an institutional archive or a discipline-specific archive. Each discipline are nowadays having their own. For example, the mathematics and physics has one of the oldest discipline-specific archive known as archive, ARXIV. Similarly, in the biomedical research, bioarchive and made archive, and there are not many cockprints. There are so many discipline-specific archives are now there. So it is known as green publication, green open access. Then we have hybrid open access. One or more open access articles in a subscription journal. You see, when there is a lot of hue and cry, and then people were reacted to the for-profit publication, and then there are a lot of many questions that what is the accountability to the government, who is basically a funding agency for most of the research. If the article is published in a closed access journal and remains out of access from the people, then there is a lot of reaction, and the movement started. And responding to the changed need and the reactions of the academia, the publishers now came down, and then they started another model of publication where they included a couple of open access articles, and the rest of the articles are paid, and a few of those articles were open access in a subscribed journal. you can find such journals. There are many such journals. Almost all the international publishers nowadays having few articles as open access, where the author has to pay for it, and for the rest of the users, it is free to access. So this kind of publications are known as hybrid open access. Then we have bronze open access, where it is free to read on the publisher's page, but like a clearly identifiable license. There is no clear-cut licensing is there. So as we have a general licensing issue or creative licenses are there, mentioning as to how the articles are to be acknowledged, whether they can be commercially used or not. So there are license restrictions are there, but bronze publications, they are not clearly mentioning the license of the articles, licensing modules of those articles. Then you have platinum open access. Here it is a publisher pay model, usually offered by the universities. So usually as gold open access, where the author pays, like platinum, the author doesn't pay, the publisher pays. So where the publisher might be an organization, a university, research or institution, so they are paying on paying for it. So this is a this is platinum publication. And the open access mainly started with as an international initiative long back, as I said, this two decades is in 2002, when the Budapest Open Access Initiative was made. So as an outcome of a congress of people related to the business of publication, libraries, and academia, actually they made a policy of open access, and this was known as Budapest Open Access Initiative. What open access is, how this all those formalities. Likewise, there is a Bethesda statement on in US open access published in 2003, in Germany Berlin Declaration of Open Access to Knowledge and Science and Humanities. So these international initiative actually set the ground for the open access to flourish. Recently, as we can see, that many countries, including US, UK, USA, and in our own country, they have their own policy of open access. So this is the movement which was started, and many of the academic people, professors, research scholars, actually they started a movement. They said that there has to be open access available. Next slide, please. Go ahead. Next one. Okay. The author pay model. The author pay model, which was actually the initial model of the gold open access, where if you want to publish an article in open access journal, then the author has to pay in order to manage the costs relating to the publication of that particular article or journal. In the journal, the web hosting and the managing the article, archiving it, and copy editing on all those publication or activities, you need to bear the cost, and the cost was borne by the author. So it was known as article processing charges. Next slide, please. So these are the when the thing started, and people realized, previous slide, please. So when gradually the academics and the people who are in research, the students, they started realizing the essence of the open access movement, so that everyone can have access to the published literature, not only those who are able to pay for it. So it has a lot of impact. Next slide. Yeah. So there is a growth of growth of institutional repositories, because the best method, which was realized in the international community,
please mute. Okay. I'll mute. Sunita Singh, please mute. Sir, this one? Just unmute, sir. Sir, this said slide?
No, previous one.
This?
Yeah.
Okay,
sir. So there has been a growth of institutional repositories. We are well conversant with the term called this institutional repositories. We in these institutional repositories are the digital archives created by the institutions where the research output is there, so that the authors' versions of the work can be archived, and immediately after the archival of those articles, everyone can have access to that free of cost and without any barrier to it. So there has been a growth of institutional repositories, and this has been a mandate of the government also today, because when you are doing research with the government funded money or government the taxpayers' money, then the research output has to be made available in the public domain. So the institutional repositories are helping to showcase the research done by the research scholars, the researchers, the scientists, the faculty, and the professors of these institutions, and make it available through institutional repositories. In India, the oldest one is the e-print at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and there are many following to it. There are many institutional repositories now as there is there. Then growth of self-archiving research papers. So we have always been very conservative in our approach till even after this the concept of the open access movement started in the earlier part of the 21st century. But gradually, the conservatism actually faded, and then faded out, and we started believing in this model of publication, because the author wants to reach to more and more audience who will actually have access to their papers. They'll read it, they'll comment it, they will work upon that. So in order to reach out to more and more, there's a self-archiving is the only means as to how they can reach. So they realized it, and this archiving or research paper, there are a lot of growth in there of research papers are there. Today now we are finding research papers in archiving, in Scholar, Google Scholar, in ResearchGate, in various such public domain archives, including our own institutional archive. And if you have the discipline-specific archive in our field, in library information science, as you know, ELIS is one of the very prominent e-archive where we would like to archive our papers in. Then institutional mandate of open access. There has to be an institutional mandate. There are a number of institutions now in India, including the Council of the CSIR, Scientific and Industrial Research, ICAR and many research agencies, they have mandated, they have made their policy of open access. By a default, they have created their institutional repository in their institutions. We have government initiatives publications, and then a commercial publisher launched a way journal. And Ajay was telling you that there are many commercial publishers who are excelling in the STM category, science, technology, and medicine category, including Elsevier, Springer, and many other. They have started with journals where a hybrid kind of open access policy. They have started where they have a few articles in open access and rest of those articles in the paid version. The next slide, please. So this is what I was telling you, the world's leading STM publishers, they have launched open access journals. Next slide. Sage is having an open access policy of their own. Springer is having this open access policy of publications. Next slide, please. Yeah, this Hiveware Press. And Doge is, as you all know, that this is a older screenshot that I have taken. Now the size of the articles have been very huge in this directive open access journals, where the journals are indexed. Open access journals from various countries have been indexed here, and it provides a platform for people to search different articles on subject on various search points, and so it is very useful for every one of us who are not having access to the print journals or the journals from commercial publishers. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Go ahead. These are actually some of the screenshots that you want to. This PLO Science, everyone must be knowing that this Public Library of Science, this was started long back in 2000, when they started with a completely open access journal. Now these journals actually proved that people who were questioning the quality of open access, now they proved it to be wrong, because now the PLS journal, particularly the PLS 1 and other journals of this PLS series, now they proved to be very highly impact journal of this traditional impact factor. It's very, very high as compared to the closed access journals. So the acceptance of the open access as a mode of scholarly communication has already been there, and we started believing in the communication, this communication process. Next slide, please. Yeah, but there is opposition to open access as well, because there are people who start criticizing the open access journals sometimes, saying that the quality is not par with the closed access journals, but the quality is not with the very basis of the journal being open access or closed access. The quality depends upon the author's hard work and the author, how much of the author has given an input to his research, and the peer review of the research papers. So the peer review is there in closed access journals as well as in open access journals. So the basis is not on this, not supporting this argument that the open access journals are less in quality than the closed access journals. But there is seen a darker side of it, because we realized that next slide, there is something called the predatory journals started, because when some of the predatory publishers who actually thought that there is a market for them, and there are some people who are looking out to publish their papers so quickly and so easily, so that that will help them for their career growth and all those things. So the publishers started actually doing their own now business, and they start a portal and publish the articles without any peer review, or without even looking at the content of those articles, which we call them as predatory publications. So you all must be knowing that, next slide, this news had came a long back in 2013, in Hindu it was published, that one sting operation was carried out by a person called John Bohannon. Okay, this is a science writer at Harvard University, and he created a research paper without any factual content into it, and everything was fabricated, and it was sent to not many publishers for publication, journals for publication. Out of 304 journals, open access journals, we found that majority of them actually accepted the paper. So this actually started questioning that time, that the open access journals are with the quality of open access journals, because their peer review process is not so so rigorous. So that was a question. But in that sting operation or so, it was found that many of the journals which were accepted, which had accepted that paper, were also commercial publications. So it is not a open access or a closed access. It is about the integrity and the rigority of the peer review process, and the which decides the actually quality of the journals, whether it is open access or closed access. Next slide, please. Another thing which actually directly affects us as a author, as a teacher, as a researcher, that the article processing charges which you need to pay. If I have prepared a paper putting in all those intellectual efforts into, and then when I am submitting a paper, if it asks me to pay, then people may not be interested. So the APC was something which actually was a negative thing for open access. But that is what the model is, because the author has to pay, then the rest of the users will get it free of cost. Next slide, please. Do you have time? No? Sorry? I have some time with me. Just another 5 minutes I'll be, because 30 minutes time was given to me. Suppose that. Okay. So the future of open access journals, the future is bright, of course. And particularly at this juncture, when we are fighting with a pandemic which has spread all through the world, and all our libraries are closed, all our book stacks are closed, we don't have access to the physical stuff, then the open access journals actually is a kind of relief to all of us. We can read and we can actually get to actually we can do the work our work regularly. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah, the change is never easy. No doubt many obstacles remain, but the enthusiasm of a new generation of researchers for open access and the ongoing expansion activity in this area by funders and policy makers together mean that open access to the results of the scientific research soon be the norm so it has already become a norm for us nowadays. It has become a new normal nowadays. You might have seen that every day we are getting n number of messages on our WhatsApp, on the Facebook, on the mails that this publisher, that publisher, this institute, that institute, and libraries, everyone is coming out with some of their stuff for open access. They're giving links for everyone to use. So this has become a new normal. The open access has become a new normal for all of us today. The next slide, please. In India, the National Knowledge Commission has recommended for the article processing charges to be given. The authors have to pay for each research article they publish in such journals, because the public funding research, the government wants that the public funding research has to appear in a public domain as a part of the open access journal. So therefore, you have to pay the APC charges, and the APC charges is approved by the funding agencies as per the policies of the National Knowledge Commission. And other such bodies like ICAR, CSIR, and UGC. Next slide. DST, DBT, all these institutions now have created a mandate for open access as a policy. So here you can see the three pillars of open access. Open access talks about a model where there are takers as well. Because if you look forward only to download the things and use them, and have nothing to upload, or I'm not interested of uploading, I'm not interested to give away my research to, then the model will be squeezed and it will not flourish properly. So in order to make the open access a successful model, we need three things: way publishing by the institutions, by the organizations, by the government, by the NGOs, and the open access support. There has to be support from, like Ajay said, that the government has come forward with their own mandates of open access, various research organizations, research agencies, Ajay said CSIR, ICAR, DBT, DST, and all those UGC, they have their OA support available. And then OA archiving. This means to the individual researchers, individual authors. If I have something good and I want that my audience to read it free of cost, then I need to archive it in an institutional archive or archive of my own, or disciplinary archives in available in my field. So next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yeah, these are the benefits of open access that I need not to say, because the first and foremost benefit of open access is you are supporting to the cause of the democratic values, because the democratic values in this scholarly communication says that the research, the scientific output, the knowledge generated, irrespective of where it is, but it has to reach to the common of the commonest person free of cost. So the open access supports this democratic value. And then the visibility increases. As the visibility increases, then people start using it, and the citations increase. If citations increase, then you get a reputation as an academician, as a researcher, that is what we, every one of us of this community actually want to be. So COVID-19 has created a lockdown situation for every one of us. And so has the situation for all those public institutions, including the libraries. So here in this new environment, where everything is safe to be closed, so the digital libraries are the new normals. Okay, the libraries are the new normals. So therefore, this I have taken from the New Indian Express, where many of the representatives from various publishing agencies, their statements are there. So how do they innovate in the times of COVID-19? There are some people who say that using our own social media platform. So there has been a rampant use of the social media, and aggressively they trying to reach out to all of us with their free stuffs. So right onto my WhatsApp, right onto my Facebook account, right onto all those social media accounts. We have Twitter, Instagram, everything. They are pouring in their resources. Yeah. And this OUP, Oxford University Press spokesperson, it says online resources and leading journals are freely accessible to assist the researchers, medical professionals. They came forward with their closed access journal, which were only available to those who paid for it, now available for open access. So there has been shift to, towards electronic books and audio books nowadays. And there has been the COVID-19 research. There has been a read from home campaign from the people, and they're trying to supply reading materials on their desktops in their houses. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah. So there has been an information revolution relating to the research on COVID-19 as well. So right from the day when it, the WHO declared it to be a disease of international concern as a pandemic, from that day onwards, different countries, starting with China and many other countries, followed to that, and the research is in full swing, and the publications are now going through a new kind of environment. Usually what you do is, after research is completed, the manuscript is sent to the publisher, they forward it to the reviewer takes their time, and after 6 months or so, the paper is published. But now we cannot afford to take that timeline, as because this is a new situation where the research has to be immediately to be made available, so that the other people who are working in other labs can have access to that, and so that it will help them to create a virtual research network. So therefore, we can reach to our goal of finding the drugs for this virus as quickly as possible. Sir. Yeah, I'm just concluding in 2-3 minutes. Okay. So there has been a lot, but as you can see that the articles are available in preprint channels. Like there are two preprint archives are there. One is the MED archive, and there is a bio archive. There are two preprint servers where most of the articles are actually uploaded without peer review. It is left for peer review of the people. Open peer review, and your article is unauthentic, it is not based on the proper scientific method, and it is a questionable scientific experiment, then it will automatically be retrieved, it will automatically be withdrawn, and many of such articles are being withdrawn also, retracted. Okay, next please. The most important positive disruptions caused by the COVID-19, the Pulitzer Prize winning journalist Michael Hissip said that this is the most disruption caused the new kind of the publishing mechanism, where most of the paid publisher, the commercial publishers are now affected. But it is very great thing that it is the paid publisher actually come forward with the open access to their resources in this particular time. It is quite encouraging. Okay, we can go for go ahead. Yeah, these are the two. So I'll be summarizing and concluding my lecture. As I said, most important thing is that to make this open access model of communication, scholarly communication, to be successful, we all of us, as an institution, as a university, as a college, as an individual researcher, as a faculty member, we should think that what I can contribute to the open access, the system of open access, and instead of searching only what is using only what is available, we always try to what you can contribute to it. And as a librarian, we have these following roles that we can play, we can do. We inform the people that many of our colleagues, many of our students, and many of the people, they are not aware that such things are available for open access. We need to inform them, make them aware of such things, how they can validate, what is the valid source, and all those things. Then train them how to use, educate them, and convert them as the conservative closed access publishers in print journals to the authors contributing to the open access electronic publications. And then we should also encourage them to for content production. If I have something good to share, then I must share it on in a public domain so that everyone else can use it. So these are the things that we can contribute as a library professional, as a part of our support to open access. So with this, I think I try to actually talk to you relating to this open access and this scholarly communication process, and how it is fitting into the context of this COVID-19 thing. So thank you so much.
Over to Amrita.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your insightful lecture. We now move on to our next resource person, Dr. Nimai Chad Shaha. He's presently working as the librarian, Central Library, Vishwabharati, Shantiniketan, West Bengal. Prior to his current attachment, he was the librarian at Kalna East Bardhaman. He has a rich working experience of 21 years. Dr. Shaha has written more than 70 articles in different journals, has published 9 books, and edited 4 conference proceedings. He is also the editor of an international journal and reviewer of 3 journals. He has attended more than 170 national and international seminars, workshops, and conferences. He is a life member of many associations like BLA, IASLIC, ILA, etc. He has been awarded many prestigious awards like Lifetime Achievements Award 2017 from IRDP Group of Journals, Universal Achievers Gold Medal Award 2015 from Universal Achievers Foundation, Special Award 2015 from SCST OBC Employees Welfare Association, Vishwabharati, Indira Gandhi Sadbhavna Gold Medal Award 2014 from Global Economic Progress and Research Association. His areas of interest include library marketing, innovative and best practices, library HRD, ICT applications in library, change management, etc. We are elated to have such an eminent scholastic personality in our midst. His topic today is open educational resources for teaching learning current context. Welcome, sir, to today's webinar. You're requested to begin to enlighten us. Dr. Shah?
Okay. So, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're
audible. Okay. Thank you. So, Sujan, let me allow to share screen.
Yes, you are now presented. Please click on share content. Okay, sir.
Is it visible?
No, sir, it's coming. Okay, sir, it's visible now. Please full screen.
Okay, so.
Okay.
Start as a second batsman of this today's one day national seminar, as has been organized by Banarilal Bhalotia College, Asansol. Before to going to my topic, extend my heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Molloy Ghatak, Honorable President, today's Chief Patron, and also Honorable MIC of Government of West Bengal. I'm also thankful to Professor, who happens to be the principal of the very prestigious institute, and also today's patron, and also organizing committee member, Dr. Kajol Krishna De, Mr. Abhijit Chakraborty, Dr. Snigdha Rai, Mr. Uddalak Dotto, Ms. Amrita Mitra, Dr. Amelendu Samanto, and also I know that this is the name of the front end, and I believe that there are many persons who are back end work, and that is why Professor's team come into this webinar. And last but not least, if I am not extend my gratitude or sincere love to my brotherly Sujan Saha, who happens to be the host of this session, so let me thank you all. And also, I don't want to forget my extend deep regards to Professor Bulu Maharana, who has been make easier my task how to be theoretically and practically examine and present before this audience the open access scholarly publication and other things. And as you know, the as the basic term, the theme of the seminar is same, so definitely some slides may come into same in fashion, but as we don't have any intra discussion amongst us with Professor Mukhopadhyay, with Professor Maharana, so it might be incidental coincidence. Okay, so now let me come to my topic, that open educational resources for teaching current context. So the presentation menu, introduction, sources of information, evaluation of sources of information, open educational resources, then open access educational resources, and if time permit, then online demonstration, finally conclusion. And you say, let me come to introduction. Since I am from Tagore's land and from the Institute of Vishwabharati, I have no way but to utter from first Asian Nobel laureate, none other than founder of our Institute Vishwabharati, that is Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, who said, which is even pertinent to our current context, is that I slept and dreamed that life was joy. I awoke and saw that life was service. I acted and behold, service was joy. Then what we found is that basically our life cycle is evolving with life, joy, and service. Life, joy, and service. If we want to get a peaceful life, then we want to devote our to the extent possible as a service holder, as a service provider, then we will gain joy. And if we will gain joy, then our life will be saturation. So life, joy, and service, that was the basic proverb, basic quotation as given by Gurudev Tagore long 100 years back, that is equally applicable and pertinent to this current pandemic COVID-19 situation. Now let me come. Where we are living. See, current society is we are having less time for a multiple works. And you know, we are living in the big all the village grocer shops and village garment shop and stationery shops, and we are now love to visit a big bazaar, a big shopping mall where we are getting multi item single visit under a roof. So that's the basic challenge. What I want to mean is that nowadays people is not having much more time to read your publication unless it will be attractive before the next day. Otherwise your publication will be as publication, you will not enjoy more and more citation. What actually we fight for? And again, you see the current society is shining India versus shrinking India, metro India versus rural India, information rich versus information poor, digital divide, public digital imbalance. And you know, because of this COVID-19 situation, the persons of a cross section or elite class, I must say, those who are able to have a chance, lucky enough to participate this kind of webinar, how much percentage of this Indian community who are going to participate in this kind of webinar? A little bit, maybe 2%, 3%, like that. So around 27%, they may be middle class, and what, 70%? So they are in the dark situation. They are in the dark. So if our basic slogan, if our basic objective is to develop India as a globe, as a citizen, then we have to have fight for total development, not only metro, not only rural, brother for all. So you see, this is the fights of the India. This is where we are having, we are living in the instant messaging society, and you see, we are living in the restaurant. These are the symbol. These are elite class where we 30% people are living. And let me showcase what about the backside of this India. You see, child labor, women labor, and you see, food crisis, shelter crisis, and everything is in mess shape. Then we are talking about open access. And why open access? And yes, as Corona at the end of his slide, he rightly explained that everything is free. Everything is having some sorts of bad and good, pros and cons. So definitely open access is not from critic, open access is not from error. Still, being the developing country, being a member of the rural India, being a librarian of the rural Indian university, I must want to cite the picture of the rural. Unless we extend our hands to this community, some portion of India may be developed, but not the total India. Now you see, how are we changing it of time? There are many examples we can take. But let me take our family story. Just end of our 20th century, when a guest become in our house, it's our, particularly to Bengali, it's our culture. When any guest come to our house, we people cooking with our own hands with different recipe to serve and satisfy and to share our foods all together in the dining table. Then we are coming, cooking with maid servant or cooking staff in the house. Means we are just managing time and forget and leaving that cooking our kitchen room. Then early of 21st century, first decades of the 21st century, we are trying to serve by enjoy with guests. It's going to take food. And in this current decade, we are asking restaurant for home delivery of ordered food in my doorstep. And during this lockdown of this COVID-19, we have to go back to our late 20th century's last decade, that we are now having no option but to serve, but to cook by our own. So what I want to introduce, or what I want to showcase, is that people basically is a kind of habitant of the changing phenomena, is the habitant of the environment, as it will gear, as it will steer the community of human society. Now let me show. The open knowledge society is having 9 family members. And that's why I am saying, okay, open knowledge to the power 9, And these are the nine. I am not uttering all the facets. And only thing, this blue color, I am just going to today's discussion and today's core theme of.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Any problem?
Sujanta sir has lost his video.
Okay, okay. I call him. He's wait.
Sujanta, onake ektu phone korun.
Okay, okay.
Depending upon the form of the resources, depending upon the situation, depending upon the terms of availability, like that. So first one is primary source, secondary source, and tertiary source. Then you see living and non-living. Then print and electronic, and open access resource, open source resource, then ownership or subscribed resources. So these are the things. From this slide, I am just trying to exemplify. What are the primary sources? What is its definition? What is its example? Simultaneously, secondary source and tertiary source. Since you all are the facets of learned society, I think when this PPT presentation in PDF form will be in your hands, it will be very much clear and transparent to you. And this is available in many URLs. So you can also suffice to get downloads. Now, this is again the example. Now this is the pictorial presentation of sources of information. You see, these are the sources of information, which is very self-explanatory. Now let me come source. There are many sources or resources is available in the society and in the web society as free, open access or open source resources. Now my question is everything useful? Whatever we are able to take it, shall we baggage it? Shall we download in my pen drive? Definitely no. So before that, if my answer is no, then how to evaluate which is needful, which is not needful, which is authentic, which is not authentic? The next few slides, I'm just going to showcase how we are just evaluate a sources of information or resources, whether it is needful to me or not, whether I will use it or not. You see, it is important to evaluate each source to determine the quality of the information provided within it. Then you see, there are five basic parameters through which we can evaluate the sources. First one is purpose and intended audience. Again, the first point may be categorized into major subheading. Again, the first subheading may be four sub-subheading. What is the purpose of the source? For example, to provide information, to persuade or advocate, to entertain, to sell a product or service. So who am I? Am I a purchaser? Am I a entertainer? Am I a kind of academician? Am I a student? Am I a scholar? Am I a scholars? So depending upon my position and time and situation, I have to figure out whether this particular information or sources is needful to me or not. Then who is the intended audience for this? Scholars and academic researchers with specialized knowledge, the general public, the students in high school, and many a times, let me give you one example. Many even academicians, they are very loved to take information from Wikipedia. But sir and ma'am, please mind that Wikipedia is basically a basic, very, very, very lucid information, which may not have authenticity, which may not be very, you know, qualitative. So that things may be used by the students of high school or some college UG students. But many a times I found that the scholarly write-up contains the Wikipedia sources. And as you know, at the right-hand button of the Wikipedia, there is every chance of editing. And even a class 4 students may add something with the Wikipedia. So you see, how foolish are we being a professor of the university, being a professor of the college, being a scholar of a minor research project of EGC funded. So we are taking copy and paste from Wikipedia. So I am not arguing that Wikipedia is a mess, but Don't try to use Wikipedia blindly. Try to cross verify with some other classic sources. Then who is the author? What are the qualifications of the author? Who is the publisher? Then you see accuracy and reliability. Is the information well researched, or it is a clerical and some sort of statement, and that has been available in the public domain, and we are making copy and paste. So my research, my project, my academic article will be a kind of clerical, not maybe qualitative, it may be quantitative. Now, currency and timeliness. When was the information published? If you were kind of belongs to science faculty, and if you are going to take a kind of 1948 any publication, most of the science, I'm not making generalized, but in case of mostly science subject, unlike history, unlike literature, the old is not gold. But in case of history and language literature and some other subject or some specific studies, definitely old is gold. So we have to think, what is the basic objective? What is the basic essence of my this write-up, this research, and this some sort of class and other things? Then objective or biasness. So that has to be done. And this URL, you can have these documents, and I am just making the ready-made home delivery food. That is why in every slide below, I am just giving you the URL so that you can extendify your knowledge when you need it to justify. Then you see evaluating sources. This is another pictorial presentation, origin, purpose, value, limitation. These four parameters we have to judge. Then this is called CRAAP criteria. Currency, relevancy, authority, accuracy, and purpose. Then this is another ACAF called accuracy, author, currency, fairness, and relevancy. By these five facets or six facets, if we ask any question to a particular document before to cite, before to reuse in my classic write-up, then you will get the answer. If it is positive, then definitely you is used. Otherwise, you may reject it, because not everything in the open access, so far as available, will not be a qualitative product. So that is a kind of efficiency, that is a kind of efficacy, that is a kind of skillness of a particular researcher, of a particular academician, whether I will use it or not. Now, open educational resources. You see, open educational resources are any type of educational material that are freely available for teachers and students to use, adapt, share, and reuse. And before to get any academic and any educational resources, we have to have FAIR, means it should be findable, easily findable, and simple way of findable, then accessible or approachable, then interoperable, then reusable. So if I found these four characters, if a particular document contains, then definitely that resource I can take it into my consideration. Then this slide is a common what Professor Maharana cited in his last part. So you see, what are the basic essence of open access? So more exposure for my work. Earlier days, when a particular academician published a paper, he or she, as a kind of lifetime achievement, make it Godrej Almirah lock and key. Without having any citation, they thought that time that it is my great golden publication, so I cannot share it with others. But in the today's current technological society and current EGCS paraphernalia and current our academic environment, context, open environment, open society, it is actually, whenever I publish any particular article, it should be made available to public domain, so that I will be getting more and more citation, so that I will be getting more and more ranking, and as a whole, my all teachers ranking will be counting to the institutional ranking framework. So that's why we need to participate in the open access movement. And then practitioners can apply your findings, higher citation rates, as I told, then your research can influence policy makers. Then the public can access your findings, common public, as I told, rural India, poor people, poor colleges, we don't have enough fund to share, to purchase all the Springer Nature Journal, all the SAGE journals, all the POCUS journals to a particular Asansol BB College for catering and imparting education. So it's quite impossible. Now, compliant with grant rules, when you just going to come up with this kind of open access URLs today, I saw something, then taxpayers get value for money.
students in developing countries can see your work, as I told. Now let me come. So these are the different, snapshot. Because I am worried whether I will be allowed to go by online demonstration and my technical, my network will be compatible or not. That's why I am just showcasing the snapshot. You see, here Open Educational Resources, this is University of Pittsburgh. They have a big list of resources. From here, you will have ample items of freely and open access resources. You can get the URLs list from here. Now you see open culture. Open culture, you see 1300 free online courses, 1000 plus MOOCs, 1150 free movies, 700 plus audio books. You see, in a college, if there is any challenge students, I mean physically disabled students, physical persons with disabilities, so we are running towards inclusive education. They are not able to consult a particular books of Asansol BB College Library, Asansol Girls College Library. So to them, this is, you see, free number of video, audio is there. So according to the user's need, we can also address the objective of inclusive education for all. Now see, this is a CODA, Community of Online Research Assignment. Here also, there are lots of things as assignment. You can, this is a teaching toolkit, blogs, assignments. If you go through it, you will get ample of sources, ample of paths to run away, even paying single paise to any others. And today, by this journey, I am giving you more than 12 crore e-books, e-journals, e-articles, database, data, research management data, and others address of this. And I am sure and confident that my senior professor Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay will come up in this dais. When he will open up his showcase, he will be given a different path and different ways when he will feel free to move forward these open access roads. Now you see,
sir, some network problem is there. Hello, Insist, sir. Okay, calling you, sir. Let me just check your internet. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello, is it audible?
Yes,
no. Okay. Then it is fluctuating. Okay. So, let me go next slide. You see, this is University of Nevada Libraries Research Guides. Then you see community, college, many academicians who all are well conversant than me, that community college nowadays is a challenge. Higher education is a basic community college. So CCCOE means Community College Consortium for Open Resources. Then you see OER repository. Okay. So then you see a guide to free and open source education. So this is called opensource.com. This site, you will get a guide to free and open source education, how to steer up. Then see, this is UNESCO, Open Educational Resources, giving many things for our help and other things. Okay. So if say, next slide.
Any problem?
Okay. Now you see, this is another website called Open Professional Education Network. Here you will get things to be done and what are the different ways. Many resources are also here freely available. Then Open Educational Resources Showcase, Community College, and Open Stacks. There are many ample scope of resources are here. Then Open Educational Resources. This is another website. And finally, this is a kind of call. Is, you know, 63 URLs. I am just making copy and paste for you all. I am just going to show you. Agriculture, then LibriVox, then UGPG, Parsala, eContent, National Library, National Digital Library, West Bengal Public Secretariat Library, West Bengal Public Library. There are many, and you see, all these are available in free website. So all these things available in free, and also complete works of Gandhi. Those who are teaching in political science, in philosophy, in common intensive nature of subject, environment, and other things. If they interested to know about something Gandhi, so you may not purchase the Gandhi's books on that. Everything, the whole complete work Gandhi is available here. And Tagore's prose, verse, drama, everything is now available in the web portal, that is http.tagoreweb.in. And you see Oxford University Press, Elsevier, McGraw-Hill, Wiley, Cambridge University Press, Taylor & Francis, ProQuest, Kurgar, World Scientific Publishing, Cambridge University Press, then MyLoft. They are the world-class publishers who are very kind enough, sensitive enough over this academic society to feed something during this COVID. So they are also kind to make a portion of their research for the public domain to make it open and free till 31st July like that. So if you access this, you will be happy to get ample of showcase, ample of resources, teaching, learning, experiences, and road journey. Tagore page. Here you will get Tagore verse, songs, novels, stories, plays, essays, and others too. And some in English too. So here it is the home Gandhi Sevagram Ashram, who are kind enough to showcase the Gandhi's works, quotes, Gandhi's complete works, and other things. Now here you will get this Director of Open Access Journal, where you will get, you see, 14,784 number of journals. This is current record, today's 2:30 p.m. up to 2:30 p.m. And 11,823 searchable article level. Then 133 countries all over the world is feeding here. And you know, 49.88 lakhs, right? Almost half crore articles is free here. So, and it should be searchable through different history, bibliography, then education, arts, general works, geography, anthropology, language, literature, law, but not social, all subject, philosophy and psychology, political science, science, music, and books and music. So everything is available here of journal articles. So you can come here, you can have the opportunity to download, but 20% of this article is having other than English language, which may not be understandable or digestive to us. So if you minus 20%, around 40 lakhs article is free to you in English on your subject. And I'm confident that on your subject, many things will be available here as free. This is called Director of Open Access Books. Here we'll get around 29,000 e-books full free to download. Then here you will get Open Door. This is a kind of open access repositories. Here you will get more than 22,000 repositories available here. It's a kind of marvelous URL or website or address where particularly the history, political science, philosophy, language literature, those who are dealing with old days culture, old days research, they might log in here and they will get ample of digitized resources of there is another gigantic thing, that is World Digital Library. Here you will get more about 193 countries between 8000 BC collection is also available here. Then open access thesis and dissertation in South Ganga, I will come later on. More than 33,000 open access thesis and dissertation free here you can have download. And this is that South Ganga is only for India, but the world. Now you see Swayam, you might be more than comfortable, more than confident that Swayam, you are listening this term. This is a platform where we can also log in different courses, uploading courses and doing courses, getting certificate, giving certificate. These are the things of Swayam. Then Swayam Prabha is also a 32 DTH channel, Government of India. Then you see so Gangotri, the origin research is called research proposal. So here is the research proposal. Soon after getting registration of any university, any college, researchers has to upload his or her research. So whenever any new gen scholar will come, how to write a research proposal, how to submit a research proposal, they will be a kind of guide from here. Also research in progress in a particular subject, what are the different research is going on in my particular kind enough to get and browse from here. And you see, this is a complete thesis database of Ganga. 260,000 theses is also available in universities. And this is called, this is actually our academic creation must be through a plagiarism software, and that is none other than Urkund, which has been purchased by Government of India through global tendering process. Based software, Swedish software. This Urkund is now every Indian institute is becoming as free. And many people in many EGC HRDC courses, I found that teachers are raising their hands and asking, can I purchase this software, that software? I say, you cannot pay single paisa for that because Government of India is giving you one free software by purchasing. So this is actually purchased software, but Government of India purchasing and giving it to us as free. So if let me invite all these 350 participants, including my esteemed institute, Asansol BB College. If any teacher would like to publish any article, if they want to face any crisis, to check their article in the Urkund, please send me the PDF file and send back you analysis report free of cost, because you are Indian, I am Indian, Government of India is giving it to free to all Indian universities. Some university may be lagging behind, some university may be front. So right today, I don't want to undermine you to gaining paise, and this will be a civil crime because I cannot earn any money by this software because this has been given by Government of India free. So please, please and please, you don't consider yourself that I am a rural college teacher, I am a rural college librarian, how can I download, how can I do these things? So Biswa Bharati, through the Tagore, we are also nurturing open access environment long back 100 years. Today we are technologically open access, but Gurudev Tagore uttered this open access, open education long. So in that legacy, we are offering this service to you all. Database. Also, a particular teacher, a particular librarian must have registered in Vidyan database, expert database, so that you can market yourself, your expertise, your publication, and you will get personal indexing ranking. And also, as a whole, your institute will get ranking, which will be helpful for the Vidyan, which will be helpful for ranking in the NRF and NAC accreditation, like that. And in the next, another portal of InflipNet. Then this is InfoPort. This is basically InflipNet showcase the gateway for Indian electronic resources, open access resources, all clapped together here. So if you don't go here and there, if you coming here, you will get many resources, philosophy and psychology, religion, social sciences, language, technology, arts and fine arts, then literature and rhetoric, history and geography. whole subject, he will get A to Z, his arrangement is here. Then this is a new thing which has been augmented, introduced by InfibNet through its portal InfibNet. It's called Indian Research Information Network System, which is internally linked with Vidyan. Once you registered yourself in Vidyan, then your data will be automatically top index, and your automatic indexing will come into being. Then you see, so
Yes, sir.
I am just coming to end. Now it is. So this is National Virtual Library. This is Government of India and Government of West Bengal, West Bengal State Secretary Library under the Home and Health Affairs Department. Then you see West Bengal Public Library Network. Here you will get more than 50,000 books digitized of Bengal culture and heritage. Then Open Society Foundation. Then you see archive.org, ARXIV called archive. Here you will get 17.17 lakhs journal articles, full free to download, which is not peer reviewed. I'm not going into deeper of this part because of time short. You will get go through here, then you will get all subjects, physics, chemistry, physics, mathematics, computer science, quantitative biology, quantitative finance, electronic engineering, many subjects are here. Then bio archive also, by its name, you understood this is biological, all subjects and you know, disciplines uploaded here. Then this is the about bio archive doing. If you go here, then you will get actually acquainted bio archives is actually meant for. Then you see fix here. Here you will get many subjects. You see agriculture, veterinary science, astronomy, then biological science, built environment and design, chemistry, commerce, management, tourism, service, humanities, health science, engineering, many more technology. Then you see, you will come here, log in, enjoy the showcase. And then this is called GitHub. This actually help us to develop different apps. If a particular college, particular apps for during admission, during physical exam, or anything. So there is a guideline how to develop an app. So this is free software by any college authority may take it. So this is shared it. Actually, this is a sister concern of Springer Nature. They have developed this shared it. So they are giving much resources full free here. Then you see, this is actually Digital Public Library of America. They are giving 3.71 crore of image, textbook, video, sounds, full free here. So you see, now it is our business whether we, because sources are available, sources are loitering here and there. Then say Paramyo, I am not going to talk about this because of time short. Then not passing. Then Dryer also kind of data repository software, research data management. So DataVault is also data management, research data management repository. Then this is a kind of open source open science framework. There are also search and discover, design your site, collect and analyze data, publish your reports. Very, very simple guide for scientific field. And then Genedo is also a kind of research data management showcase. Then kind of shortage of time, I'm not going to online demonstration. And then you see, in conclusion, what I am going to say, society is open, nature is open, knowledge is open, library is open, resources is open. Basic thing, we are uttering, lecturing, all these things will close mindset, will close attitude. So my humble comment at the end that we need to update our attitude, we need to update our mindset to make it open, to make it open, to make it open, to ensure the basic development, basic ahead of Government of India, of nation, of global level like that. And I being a library professional, and on behalf of all library professionals, I want to give you one short message that our path is very clear. But sometimes in road you can find a storm and water and like that. So library people is there like a mother giving umbrella to her child. We all try to, every time we always try to extend my for your safe journey in academic. Please don't pay much time, don't pay alone, don't say that you are alone. Please take any librarian said, I think in a year if you publish two articles, it will be three. Because if you take help from the librarian, and we are ready to extend our umbrella for your safe journey. Thank you for bothering me with your careful listening and other things. Again, if I don't get chance, let me extend gratitude for inviting and offering me to deliver my experience in this forum. If anything disheartened to anyone, please bear with the situation. I don't want to have any intention to sort of disheartened anyone. That may be some sort of kind of a flow of other things, because you know technology and other things sometimes giving trouble to me. So with these few words, thank you all. Thank you. Sujan, over to.
Okay, am I audible?
Yes,
ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, sir. For your informative and illuminating address. Our next speaker is Dr. Partho Sharuti Mukhopadhyay. Sir is Professor and Head of Department of Library and Information Science, Kollani University, Kollani. He is the recipient of the Best Young LIS Teacher Award and has worked as a developer and promoter of many open source projects. He has published more than 100 papers in journals and conference volumes and has 5 books to his credit. His book on interoperability and retrieval has been published by the UNESCO. Professor Mukhopadhyay has also acted as metadata consultant for the project National Digital Library, hosted by IIT Kharagpur. He is presently a member of the advisory committee for National Virtual Library Project under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India. He is also instrumental in developing Vidya Online, an e-learning portal for 2006, and is presently running 3 online courses on the Swayam platform. We are honored by his august presence in today's webinar. His lecture is titled Virtual Learning Environment, VLE, is the New Normal, Text and Context. Welcome, sir. We are delighted to have you with us today. Dr. Mukhopadhyay?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Kindly initiate
the lecture. Okay. So, a very good evening to all of you. My co-speaker in this webinar and organizers and the dear participants. So, I will be trying to be brief. I'm directly jumping into my topic. So my two previous speakers already told you. I hope that I am clear enough and audible enough. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So my two previous speakers already talked about mines of information before you. But I am raising a very important question to all the academicians present here and my fellow library colleague, that what to do with these resources, how we can improve our teaching, learning, evaluation process and library services, and possibly in an integrated manner, that how we are going to utilize those mines of resources. Already Nimai pointed out that almost 50 lakhs of research papers are available free of cost. In fact, by the year 2031, 100% of knowledge resources will be available in the open access channel. Presently, it is available only 47%. But in future, almost 100% of knowledge will be available, and that is not too far, only 2031. So I'm starting my presentation right from here, and mostly I'll be trying to have some live demo.
Shersky nuance.
Okay. Can you see this?
Yes, sir. Full screen. Yes, sir.
Okay. Full screen. So how COVID-19 is actually going to change our teaching learning evaluation process? In fact, all kind of open access knowledge objects and OER, you are getting the list, you can have it. So how we can utilize that part in our teaching learning evaluation, including academic research? But I would like to mention one thing here, that before you objects available to as it is in your e-learner, you need to be licensing system associated with object. There are two licensing systems coming up very quickly. One is the Creative Commons licensing, which have six varies. Another is rightstatement.org. So critics that what CC, then you please read those kind of freedoms associated with the license of the open knowledge object you are trying to utilize, and act accordingly, because that is very important. Nowadays teachers and librarians need to be very careful about the copyright, and open licensing system is basically a copyleft system, so that also includes different degree of freedom associated with it. So there is no restriction, CC0, commercial activity restriction for derivative activities, that there is CC BY SA NC ND, stands for non-commercial, ND stands for non-derivative. So we must be very careful about utilizing those resources. Something available in the public domain, that does not mean that you can reuse that particular knowledge object in your e-learning system. So that is my very first message. So in the terminological plane, we call everything e-learning, but everything is not e-learning. First of all, when you are utilizing your LCD presenter, your video conferencing tool, a soft copy of your presentation, soft copy of your lecture note you are sharing with your students, that all becomes part of the e-learning system. But the real e-learning came with the advent of networking system that we call digital learning environment. When your courseware in a structured manner available to the learners over the network in an interactive mode, then we call it digital learning environment. That's why your TV system is not a digital learning environment, because that is not interactive in nature. But basic LCMS, learning content management system, is a web-enabled learning content management system, is a digital learning environment. Then came the tools called asynchronous mode of communication and synchronous mode of communication. Say, for example, this web conferencing software we are using, WebEx, that allows us a synchronous mode of communication. Real time we are communicating. But there are many asynchronous mode of communication, like your email system, like your blog posting. So those are not in real time. You are doing actually in half duplex mode. So when those kind of asynchronous and synchronous tools of communication linked with your digital learning environment, that becomes virtual learning environment. And when virtual learning environments is integrated with other institutional hub system, like library, like your admission, like your examination, then different other kind of financial subsystem of your college or university, then we call it's a managed learning environment. It will provide a student or a learner a single window interface to access every single facilities of your institute. So that is the future. Presently we belong to the virtual learning education environment era. And MOOCs, you already know, Dr. Saha already mentioned it, the MOOCs. And anything you are utilizing, DLE, VLE, or MLE, alongside your day-to-day traditional classroom-based teaching learning evaluation, that is called a blended learning. So in future, possibly in India, for the time to come, in the coming 5 years, we will be possibly practicing blended learning, utilizing different facets of learning. But for each of them, like DLE, MLE, or MOOCs, The building block is digital learning objects. And what my previous speakers, Professor Maharana and Dr. Saha mentioned, it's an input to the teacher.
Hello, sir. Are you not coming?
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir. Not audible.
Okay, please wait. PSM, sir. Sir, hello, sir. Can you hear me?
Calling. You're not available, sir.
Hello, not audible.
So wait, please wait. Sir, trying to connect for you. Please wait. I request to all participants, please wait. Sir, please unplug your headphone and plug it again, sir, if you hear me. Okay, sir. Sir, please join over mobile, sir. I send you the link.
Yes, hello.
Yes, sir.
From what time you are not getting me? Last 2-3 minutes.
And just
minute.
Okay. Because it is raining heavily here, and there is a disturbance network.
Okay, sir. It's going.
Screen?
Yes, sir.
You are getting the screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So I hope that from these slides I am disconnected. So I am again telling you that because of this three different concepts are there: DLE, VLE, and MLE. And for all these concepts, the building block is digital learning objects. These digital learning objects can be repurposed, can be resequenced, and all are attached with different kind of metadata systems. So IEEE LOM, LRMI, etc. And virtual communication tools, as I told you, that asynchronous and synchronous communication tools are basically helping us in building virtual communication and virtual learning environment. So VLE by definition is a growing and dynamic environment in which education is changing culturally, institutionally, and technically. MLE, as I told you, that it's a VLE when attached institutionally. Hello, I am getting noise from your side. Is my voice is clear?
Yes, sir. It's continuing.
Everything is clear, na? Anything went bad, please. Okay, Sujan, anything went bad, you just give me a message or a text.
Okay.
I'm having my phone here. Okay. So a managed learning environment is basically combining all kind of your institutional subsystem like your library subsystem, etc. So all kind of OER and open knowledge object, we can utilize our e-learning system, but the game of the rule is changing rapidly. As a teacher, you now need to have all knowledge related to the licensing system, related to how to create your video learning objects, how to create a further reading list by following a standard citations format like APA, MLA, or Nature standard. Then you also need to know that how to handle a learning content management system. So presently here I am trying to do a virtual presentation kind of thing for the future teaching learning environment, and how a library can interact with that particular environment. What will be the role of the library? Possibly for the academic libraries, the ball game is also changing, because the library is basically a sister library, particularly is a sister concern of an institution, educational institution. So if the basic ball game of institution based teaching learning system is changing, the library needs to be changed as well. So what will be the difference between the VLE and traditional learning environment, that is TLE? In VLE, learning materials and resources available within the system, a very important point for the librarians, because presently in traditional learning environment, beyond classroom, we give a list of reading list, a list of suggestions for further reading. Then my students go to the library to collect those materials. In future, that won't be available. Libraries needs to be present inside the e-learning workflow. In e-learning system, or VLE, we are based on online assessment and different kind of testing. Here, traditional learning, the physical examinations. VLE is most importantly user-driven timing and schedule. For example, two students of the same subject, not the same entity. As a teacher, you must be knowing that their learning pace are different, their interest profile varies. So how can you assume that the same 45 or 1 hour of teaching on the same content will trigger both two students in the same way? That is not possible. So if we allow the time, a user driven time and schedule for learning, it can do miracle in case of present educational system. Whereas in case of traditional learning environment, we follow a factory model. We call all the students in an institutional driven time and schedule system. Then we process them inside the classroom, and finally end of the graduation or post graduation, we send them to the employability or to the market, just like our factory model. So that can be improved through virtual learning environment. Virtual learning environment is coupled with different kind of real time communication tools like discussion forum, chat room, video conferencing, wiki, blogs, that can supplement the classroom based teaching in case of traditional learning environment. And the last point is really very important. As a teacher, I simply do not know what my students are doing beyond the classroom, beyond the class hours. But here, I can track every second of my student, what they are doing inside my e-learning system, what object they have accessed, what they have downloaded, what video tutorial they have viewed for how many minutes, at exactly in which frame they withdrawn themselves. So everything, a live log kind of thing, and I can take a decision how to improve my learning objects and tutorial. So that scope is not available in a traditional learning environment. So as I said, that possibly in India will be somewhere in between the TLE and VLE. It will be the judicious mixture of VLE and TLE in future for a teacher as well as a librarian. But if you want to take my personal view related that how COVID-19 is playing a big factor in teaching learning evaluation, then I will not recognize COVID-19 at all a factor in shaping our present teaching learning evaluation activities. Okay, you can consider it is a catalytic factor. It is actually provoked something rapidly. But lockdown or no lockdown, e-learning already came to stay with us. So I am giving three other reasons why e-learning is becoming very important for Indian educational system. First one is the scenario of higher education in India. Second one is that we are presently having a very big advantage that is called demographic bonus. And third is the budget of higher education. All three factors are leading to the same goal of e-learning. So I'll be very quick. We have 1,000 universities, 40,000 plus colleges, 10,000 plus institute of national importance. But I'm not going into details of this because I'll be in rural area, but the college density is not at par. The district is having 80 colleges, followed by the Jaipur, 566 colleges. But if you go to Bihar or Assam or any other eastern state, it will be diminishing like any state, etc. So,
video. Video, sir. Audio breakfast.
Okay. Now it's okay?
Okay, sir.
Hello? Okay, fine. This is the situation in the college. Is 7 in Bihar, whereas 53 in Karnataka. For per lakhs of eligible people, that is the people belonging to the age group of 18 to 23. The real problem is the gross enrollment ratio. In India, we have a gross enrollment ratio, that is the people of the age group of 18 to 23, how they are enrolling themselves in the higher education system is only 26.3. If you want to compare it with China, they already crossed 50. If you want to compare with the South Korea, they already crossed 85. US, it is 81. So you can see how badly or poorly we are performing in GER, gross enrollment ratio. This is one point of thing. Second point of thing, I'm quickly jumping, shortage of teacher, shortage of educators, and progression of the students. Student, only 0.5% of the total enrollments in higher education actually completes their PhD product. So last year, you see, it is even less than 0.5%. Most of the PhD students are doing their PhD in science and technology, but whereas the most of the students enrolled in arts, humanities, and social science. So most of the students enrolled in only 10 programs in India. 80.3% of the students, total students are only enrolled into 10 programs, all 10 belonging to arts, humanities, and social sciences. Student program to PhD is only 0.5%. As I already said, that we have shortage of educators. Pupil-teacher ratio in universities and colleges 29. If you go to college, it is around 30. If you come to university, it is allowing almost 20. But in developed countries, a university system must have a 1:5 teacher-student ratio. But we are far beyond that. Now, another interesting thing is we have no GER, 26.3 only, but even this particular GER is varying like anything. So if you go to the Delhi NCR area, they are higher than the national level, 50.6, almost double. If you come to the southern part of the country, all are slightly higher than the national average. Definitely, Tamil Nadu and Kerala is on the higher side. But if you consider the entire western, central, and eastern part of the country, we are all lagging behind the national average. That means even if you consider the West Bengal alone. So in West Bengal, we are having almost 19.3. Northeastern states, some of the northeastern states are doing very good, Mizoram, for example. But entire western, central, and eastern India is not doing quite enough. In Odisha, it is 21.1. And so in Jharkhand and Bihar, it is less than that. So thing is that what I am trying to say, we have a very good, very big educational institutional system, but this is not the finest. This is uneven. Uneven in terms of the GER, uneven in terms of college density, uneven in terms of the number of educators available. So That is the problem with this thing. So government of India wants to reach to the unreached with the best of the business teaching capabilities of the country. So the e-learning is the only solution for that. Now this is a comparative study of GER of India with other developing countries. Hello. Okay. So you see here a green line for South Korea. They already jumped 80%. The blue line is for Japan. But you see the India and China, which is better than China, fought neck up to 1995. Then China made a quantum jump and they are almost at 50. We are still struggling with 25-26. This is the situation of gross enrollment in higher education. If you cannot bring your best of the talents inside classroom, then how the further advancement of research development can take place? And class comes from the masses, as once Mao Zedong said. In fact, Mao Zedong was a librarian, assistant librarian of Peking University. He once said that the class comes from the masses. And if you do not have masses inside your classroom, then it is very difficult to bring or classes from that masses. Okay. So why I am much concerned about the GER because of this. Say the contribution of an educational system is actually judged by what you are contributing back to the knowledge system, and contribution you are back you are returning to the knowledge pool is basically measured through different kind of article publication. We focus database from 96 to 2000. US published 120 million research. China published almost 60 million research paper. For India, we still manage position in top 10. We published only around 16 million research paper. So even UK, the size of the district of India is producing 34 million research papers produced 34 million research paper during this period. So this is the after effect of no GER in higher education. You know, definitely the poor student progression. So we are having low GER, uneven quality, and shortage of educators. Solution is e-learning. How I am coming? But the second is another important tool, demographic bonus or demographic dividend. Demographic dividend means that the your working age population, that is the people in the age group of 15 to 64, is larger than the non-working age population, that is the people below 14 and people older than 65. So this 54 years population, when higher than the non-working population or your non-dependent population is higher than the dependent population, then we call it is the demographic bonus for the country. But during this demographic bonus, you will be amazed to know that the median age of India is now presently, it is calculated on the top of 2018 data, only 21.8.1, whereas in Japan it is 47.3, China 37.4, Germany, the oldest one in the Europe, 47.1. So you will be the youngest nation for the coming 37 years. So that is called demographic bonus window. Our demographic bonus started in 2018 and it will be ended in 2055. Fortunately, by the grace of the got a 37 years of dividend window. So our we will be the youngest nation of the world, and most of the workforce will be supplied from India. But if they are not skilled enough, they won't become unemployable. And if you cannot route this young energy to the right channel, that can lead to different kind of social unrest in future. And demographic bonus is not only the single factor that can lead us. Let me give you one example. So Japan entered demographic bonus group from era in 64 to 2004, and they enjoyed a 40 years of window. And you see the spectacular growth Japan made during this. If you come to the China, they enjoyed the same thing, 37 years of window. 1994 they started, 2031 they will be ending, because China is growing old now. So during this period, you expect the growth. India, it started in 2018, we have time, and it will be ending in 2015. You see here in the graph below, I have shown you that 1960 to 2018, how our working not dependent population, that is the people below 40 and over 65, are decreasing, and working age population, people within the age group of 54 to 15 to 64 are increasing, and this window will be going to stay up to 2055, then it will be again slowly increasing. So we have to utilize this demographic dividend or demographic bonus window if we want to survive in the future, struggle between other with the other countries in the economic front, in the research front, the knowledge front. Now, if you say that we have two one advantageous factor, but the problem is that when we reward maximum amount of fund support from the government, at that point of time it is actually decreasing. So if you compare the 2014-15 to 2017-18 data, I have recent data also, I will show you that it is steadily decreasing percent of the central library central budget. So 14-15 it was 6.15, but 17-18 it is only 3. It is only 3%. I am getting echo. Hello.
Okay, sir. Muted. Okay, sir.
Okay. Muted. Now again, suppose if you consider the same thing, that is the percentage of GDP or total educational expenditure, that is also diminishing. I have the current data 14-15 to 19-20 is a revised estimate. We reduce from 4.14% to 3.40%. Percentage of total educational expenditure as percentage of GDP is also decreasing from 0.53 to 0.45. So things are not quite encouraging. On the one hand, we have demographic dividends. On the other hand, we have requirement of infrastructure investment, but funding is not supporting in the higher education system. So in this particular situation, e-learning is possibly the only solution. It's a low-cost solution where by utilizing a handful of teachers. For example, you see in Siam, we are running a library automation course, only 3 teachers are there, and we have 8,000 students per session. So this kind of massive educational program to reach the unreached, to reach the at the village level, is the demand of the time, and e-learning can solve into technical details. So what modern government of India is following, it is called a 4-layer architecture. So at the back end, we have a repository. Then the repository is connected to a front end called LCMS. So our students will be having different kind of learning content management system like Moodle, BSP, .rln, etc. In number of open source candidate softwares are available. They can be integrated with the CMS also, content management system. But at the center of, or at the core, there will be an IDR on off e-learning object, that is called LOR, learning object repository. For example, I am giving you, Nimai was talking about this NPTEL, then our e-GAN course from IGNU, then CECLOR. These are all coming up learning object repository, like your institutional digital repository. They will hold the learning objects. Those learning objects will be coupled with the metadata, sequenced, uniquely identified, and that can be utilized by any teacher in their corresponding e-learning course. So that is the model we are following. This is the another explanation. But the content level architecture, suppose this is the technical architecture government of India has proposed, and they have already implemented through Swayam. Swayam is based on the top of OpenEdX architecture. But the content level architecture, they have also given a model called the ecosystem of the. So for example, if you go through the Swayam ecosystem, so you have central and state universities as partner. Teachers are actually not coming from the heaven, they are coming from central and state universities. We have different kind of training assistants or training provider at the lab level. Learners are there, they are the main stakeholder. Then different kind of either existing platform of universities or Swayam platform or other platform can be integrated with Swayam, and there is protection. The entire term is based on skills learning as a teacher, developing your course material, you need to follow the four quadrant approach. Quadrant one is e-tutorial, video tutorial on the topic you are covering. Quadrant two is the e-text in the form of your slide presentation or PDF to support that topic. Quadrant three is the list of web resources. And here comes the input from Professor Maharana and Dr. Saha. Say, Government of India categorically told teachers that in quadrant three, if you are giving the further reading list, then you must utilize open content as far as feasible, as far as practicable. Try to refer to the costly commercial sources. So there you need to have all kind of e-books, e-journal articles, so that you can utilize, you can link those which are available under Creative Commons licensing system. Then quadrant four is the self-assessment, online assessment, MCQ-based test, etc. So you first develop, try to crystallize your syllabus into topics. Each topic of a particular unit must be supported by the four quadrant. So EPG, e-learning initiative taken by InflipNet has also given that kind of, model. It is entirely in India. Doing e-learning, you have to follow four quadrant approach. And I have already said what are the quadrants. So this real challenge will be coming that how to learn different kind of e-learning tools. Most of those are available free of cost. How can you go for the screen capturing? How can you go for the video recording? How can you link your video with the YouTube? Because video, when you are utilizing video, do not jam your LCMS with video. You open a YouTube channel for your college free of cost, and all teachers can upload their video there, and you can link that video inside your LCMS like Moodle, so that your server is not actually getting pressure from the video streaming. Video streaming is done by the YouTube server, and you can safely serve your user without any, this buffering problem and delay problem, that kind of thing. So let me now go to the theories we have covered so far. So please report me whether you can see my browser or not. Okay. You can see this, right? Okay. I will be, increasing size. Don't worry. So what I am trying to show you here, that how can we go for this kind of library integrated e-learning system? Say, this is one of the course, I hope you can see this. So this is one of the example course I am showing, library service platform I am offering over system. So it's an e-learning system we are following, and it's an open source system called Moodle. And I have followed the content architecture given by Government of India, as I am closely associated with the SWAYAM and running presently three courses on the top of SWAYAM. So that model actually I followed in my own course. There is a software elective course for my student, library service platforms. So you see how we have designed it. So the first started my course. The first objective of this particular, you can have it from your syllabus. Then a glossary of the technical terms, LSP gloss available in the domain, so that you need not to be find a particular technical term every time. We have a collaborative tool, that is the glossary. I invite my students also to define different kind of terms there with proper referencing. So that kind of collaborative learning you can develop. Announcement, suppose I want to announce that day after tomorrow I am going to have a class, or we are going to have an exam. I can set announcement here. This particular solution will send email to each of my learner automatically, and they will be coming to know. So there is a service. If I click, a chat window will open. So I'm getting echo. Okay, fine. So I can open a chat window here. I can determine the time. So this time I am going to attend my chat session. So all doubt clearing sessions can be conducted here over a particular topic. I can have a discussion forum or even I have a discussion here. I can have a classroom inside my this thing. So every time I can determine or I can announce my classroom here. So it's a virtual classroom kind of thing. We are utilizing here big blue button. So my student can click join session. So they can join a session and that will be having, you know, a whiteboard, a chat service, everything integrated. So let it come. I am now going again back here. So with this generic kind of facilities, then my will be starting. So this is the syllabus of unit 1 library ecosystem. So first we can give a list of references for all are available. I am utilizing open knowledge object, different kind of open access articles or technical reports, etc. So these are all available under Creative Commons licensing. So this is the reading list. This is the major or main reading. After completion of the reading, I am starting my course. So this is my e-text, this is presentation, and this is my video tutorial on a given topic. So when my student click on this one, so they can have an embedded kind of video, you know, PDF file there. So this is the reading list or major, you know, e-text on the topic, around 8 to 10 pages. So just try to keep this as, you know, short, maximum 10 pages as e-text. It should give a summary kind of thing because you are already giving them the reading list. So there is the slide or presentation on the very topic. So presentation will be uploaded here. My student can have presentation here. 1, 2, 3 and so on. Then after this presentation is over, I can utilize a video tutorial. So this video tutorial I have uploaded in Igloo server. They have kindly given me place there, but you can open up a channel in YouTube and you can link. So suppose if my student click this one, so a video will be embedded and they can run it.
So is the emergence of the online system, local area network, etc. But the real trend setting process started in library automation in the decade of 80s.
I am again going back. So when this particular is over, unit 1, now I can set the different kind of evaluation kind of thing. So assignment, so they can submit this assignment, I can check from my system. Then after the assignment submission over, I can go for different kind of MCQ test. And after this assignment and MCQ, I can publish the result, that is the final grade. The system can do that. Don't have to do anything. You just determine the, you just give the weightage that MCQ one has what kind of weightage, etc. Can have the result. So I can in, you can see it from here that, so who stood first in MCQ one, what she got, MCQ 2 result, total unit result, total percentage, and the letter grade according to the KU system. So in this way, I can publish my result, I can take assignment, I can upload this thing, and that we all can do without any spending any cost. Say for example, in case of a college, you can either, Moodle is an open source software, you can have a Moodle server in your college itself, which is available in local you know, environment, LAN environment. Or you can have a Moodle you know, service provider system, or you can you know, buy cloud space and install Moodle there. So it will be costing around only 10 to 12,000 per annum. So that's almost nothing for a college nowadays. So in this way, the entire system we have built, so there are three units, so unit 2, unit 3, so all are supported by the four quadrant approach, reading list, my own presentation and slide, video tutorial, and finally assignment. So libraries will be doing, as I said, in a VLE, libraries will be the part of the system. will be part of the system. So in a library, suppose I am showing you another thing, as both Professor Maharana and Nimai already, I'm calling Nimai. I hope Nimai won't be my own mind anything, but okay.
Like career.
Okay, okay. Okay. So this spontaneously, Dr. Saha, and it's not actually coming out. Okay, Nima. So don't mind. Okay. So Nima is a very, you know, close brother-like friend to me. So I hope, I'm sorry, I'm not properly mentioning the Kaksi. Anyway, I hope Nima won't mind. Anyway, so another system I'm showing, that what will be the future role of libraries there. As Nima said, or Professor Maharana also said, that the future will be emphasizing on audiobooks and e-books. And I am telling you that in future, in a virtual learning environment, your student should have everything in a single window. So what to do that? So here you see that beautiful open standard is coming presently, that is called LTI, Learning Tools Interoperability, through which library software like Koha, ViewFind, DSpace, all can be integrated with Moodle. That means their search interface, the OPEC related information. I do not have to go to the library physically. I do not have to go to the library OPEC physically. Everything will be coming inside my learning interface, and I will be enjoying everything in the single window system as a learner. So here you see, what do I mean by that? So suppose there is another course we are doing from second semester, where in you all know, you can see this second site, that you all know the Indian version of WorldCat, integrated WorldCat, integrated search for different kind of bibliographic database, because nowadays are open access resource coming in a big way. So there are green path, gold path, bronze path, then there are different kind of OER. So librarians are trying to develop a single window search interface like Base and other full text search services. Those can also be integrated. So first of all, let me tell you, suppose what is the presence of my library OPEC, because most of the college libraries are already having OPEC that can be integrated. Suppose this is based on something on cataloging. So I'm searching a book on, say, gods. So you see what happens. I am not going out of this module. I am clicking this god. So within the same interface, you see I am not leaving module. Within the same interface, it will go and contact my local Koha, or it can be available in the cloud. It does not matter. I can see these are the books available. So any of this book, I am opening. Say the gods of India, I want to read, or I want to check. So the gods of India, the details of the book came. Here you see, this is the OPEC full details of the book. It can show you the number of copies available. I hope it is visible. It is visible.
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay. So suppose I have read the Gods of India. I can know different kind of holding information. These are all very common to know OPEC. And this OPEC, the beauty integrated inside the model. But you see what additional things we can do. Suppose this book is available in e-text, so I can link my book in the read, slightly increasing the size so that you can see. So we customize Koha OPEC in such a way that apart from this cataloging information, holding information, I can open up the book as it is basis, and my student can read it here. They can bookmark, they can search. I can utilize a local book reader there. I can link this book with, if it is available through different open access channels like DOAB or Internet Archive, that is archive.org, or HappyTrust, or Open Library. Anywhere if this book is available, suppose this book is available as open access from openlibrary.org, so I have linked that. And interestingly, suppose these books, how many words are there, what is the word frequency, what is the term surcharge, everything I can measure. So if I click text analysis, so it says, so what are the most important phrase of this particular things? I can increase the size, say top 215 terms, or top 200, say top 300 terms. So in this way I can increase. I can even go for different other kind of analysis service. So nowadays OPAC can be enhanced like anything. Say for example, I want to visualize the term bubbles. So what top terms are utilizing in this way? So these are the top terms graph. So if I include sound, you see every bubble will create a sound. So my point is that nowadays you can integrate your all library services, and those services can be enhanced like anything. Suppose I am a researcher in English language or in Bengali script. Suppose I am doing research as Nima is there and Rabindranath. The same thing can be done with the Bengali documents also. Suppose I am searching now by Gitanjali. So this book suppose available here. So Gitanjali is available. Now I can read the book. So many copies of Gitanjali, suppose this one is coming from Internet Archive. I can increase the size right from here, zoom out or zoom in. There is a zoom out. I can search, or I can browse the different copies, just like a reader like your book reader like Kindle or any other services. Now suppose I want to analyze the content of Gitanjali. If I click, so it will show you the what are the topmost term utilized in Gitanjali. You can increase every time. You can change even different kind of tool like TextArt. So which term is related to which term in Gitanjali? So every time, even I can set the context. Suppose I want to see how Tomar is related in Gitanjali, how Amar is related to Gitanjali, and every time it show link in proper time, and even at the same time it can create the text arc kind of thing. You see one of the beautiful tool developed. So text arc will show you real time how Rabindranath Thakur utilize various word, you know, consecutively according to the term or frequency. So this kind of different kind of text analysis alongside the full text we can do, and we can integrate that with our e-learning system. So with this I would like to end my presentation, because almost 40 minutes I have taken. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Are you audible?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for this informative session, and your demonstration is very good. Now we have an interactive session. Some question has been asked by our participants, and we have already sent to the WhatsApp of the concerned resource person. So Bulu Maharana sir is not here. He cannot join now. So yes, over sir, to Nimai Babu.
Sir present in participant list. Morana sir?
Morana sir has.
Yes, sir.
Is Mohana sir present?
No, 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 no. Okay, okay.
Over to Nimai Babu.
So, screen share me.
Screen share me.
Hello, Sujan. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Is it visible?
No, sir. Sir, stop and open it again.
Not visible?
No, sir.
Okay, so let me share.
Abhijit da kichu prashno pathiyeche apnake.
Neema, we can hear you. You can go answering.
Okay.
Sujan, is it now visible? Still coming, sir. No, sir.
Okay. Not coming.
Continue, sir.
Okay, so. Okay. So I have been given one question, that is there any site for OE directory? Answer is yes, there is a site called OSIS. Open. It's open, na? So yes. This is actually a site for directory of open access OER. Here actually common of learning. There you can have, anyone can have many resources, open educational resources. This was the first question. And also, is there any site for UGPG textbook as OER? Is question in European countries UGPG pattern, but in India it is UGPG pattern. But in college, most of the colleges we are teaching UG and universities PG. But in case of our Jadavpur and this Vishwabharati, we are having UGPG integrated university course. So there is no that kind of special URL and websites where you can have EGPG, but EGPG basically means for electronic books on EPG parcel, electronic source on EPG parcel, as enunciated by InfibNet, that is there. But here I also say textbook for university students, there anyone can have e-books on different subjects. Okay. Then you see another of the people. So this is people actually, everything is free, even tuition fee is free. If any student would like to do any degree, there is no paisa. They can take admission, they can take enrollment, they can take a resource material and take examination, everything free, and they can complete their course full free, which is purely called open access. But for IGNU and NETA issuers, they are having some sort of money for admission and other things, but it is full free. So this is actually open access course and university. That is called People's University. Then university ebook. Here also we are having many ebooks on UG and PG, but particularly faculty member and student may have their site on particular resource syllabus oriented titles. They can find out whether a particular title is available in DOAB, in books, in eVasta, in internet archives, and many things. If it is there, then there. And also, there are many books in NDLI, National Digital Web of India. The headquarters is at IIT Kharagpur. They are having 1.5 crore e-resources. From there, we are also entitled to get many e-books. Here you see, there are many e-books on different subjects, Unix, Linux, web technology, database system, medical, Microsoft. And also you see, in mathematics, different branches, abstract algebra, different subjects. And this is e-books. This is biology books, this is physics books, this is mathematics books, this is networking books. So subject specific guideline will be there, but after opening the book, candidate has to judge, or teacher has to be feasible or adjustable or commensurate with the need of the particular UG students. So in this way we can serve, but not that UG PG like that, but DOER is there.
question was there, how to access as much as information related to one's research topic. Question, one's research topic will be defined. If I am doing research on, I would have to search, let's say DOA, more than 11,000 articles of library science. So after taking entry in the library science subject, I can put up my search term, I can put up my interested area. Then that will reflect the different titles, different articles and other things. Once it is available, that will come there. Then I may go to the DOAB, Internet Archives, South Asian Archives, World Digital Library, our public library network. Many URLs are there. There we can put up my particular title and keywords. Then I can have my research area. But how can one understand? Yeah, it is echoing. Sujan, it is echoing. So how can any publisher or any provider understand what is one's requirement? So based on one's requirement, one has to customize his or her search term based on a particular website and URL. They can go there. On Google, I think they go that 63 URLs what I have given and some URL pages and screenshot I have given and what Professor Mahorana is showing and what our beloved elderly person Mukherjee also showing, how can we show this kind of virtual learning environment, those things. So we can practice these things and we can expedite this. If problem, that question may be again throw to my mailbox or WhatsApp or call to me. I will to certain ones get how to proceed. Okay. So with this, I think I will be able to address the questions of the participants, and I am worried whether the participants is in the audience or not. So if it is, then I will be happy. Thank you.
Thank you.
It is over.
Thank you. Audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes.
Now we are going to Professor. Now we are going to Partho Sarathi Mukhopadhyay, sir. Hello.
Hello. Okay, I can hear you.
No. One question is, sir,
yes.
is there any process of online evaluation?
I have shown you now that any kind of LCMS, suppose here I am using open source system Moodle. So each open source LCMS, learning content management system, supports all three facets of online education, that is teaching, learning and evaluation. Evaluation can be based on either on the basis of online assignment submission, or it can be based on, you know, MCQ kind of test or short answer type of text, or even you can go for the long answer type of text with the time limit and the word limit. So all are possible, quite possible. We are doing it.
Okay sir.
So you send me
continue, sir.
Okay, so you send me three questions here. So let us see, let me answer these three first, then I can again continue with the questions you are having. First one is that definitely a teacher asks that what is how it is possible to integrate fluid learning in field-based subject like anthropology. Excellent question. That's why I encourage all teachers to kindly come to the e-learning domain, because without this kind of questions, how can we, you know, move further? Because what I have shown you, a very kind of simple, straightforward kind of thing, I am giving e-learning content, then people are my students are giving exam, I am publishing result, okay. But the fluid learning, virtual remote lab for required for science teacher, for computer science teacher, virtual programming lab, all kind of plugins are available in Moodle. And if you want to integrate any of these plugins inside your Moodle server, that is possible. But definitely before providing a virtual lab, a virtual programming lab, or your fluid learning things and like based on fields study based subject like anthropology, definitely plugins are there. We have to learn and we have to integrate that inside the Moodle. And if you kindly take a visit to the Moodle plugins directory and search by fluid learning, you will be seeing 2-3 plugins are there. You can evaluate them by reading different kind of views given by the participants, and then you can select one and can integrate one. So the second question is that, is smart classroom is related with e-learning? Definitely. So for example, present day teachers are taking different kind of online classes through Jitsi app, through Google Meet, through Zoom, this way. Inside Moodle, there is an option that you can integrate Big Blue Button, a real-time classroom-based app which can accommodate your students. You can have there a whiteboard kind of thing. You can have your virtual chat with your students, and you can explain same way what you are explaining in a physical classroom. So smart classroom is already integrated inside LCMS. Third question is that, any process of online evaluation for the student of college? I already said that there are lot many options are there. Even you can opt for video-based comprehension test or audio-based comprehension test. Presently, what we are doing, we are giving a raw text, and on the basis of that, we ask a few questions. Instead of that, I can even run a video and ask a few questions. So that kind of flexibility, innovativeness is associated with the online evaluation. And take it from me, I am telling you, dealing with this e-learning system for the last 10 years, almost every facet of teaching learning evaluation is presently covered by LCMS. These are very matured now, and I have already shown how different other systems can be integrated inside your e-learning system, like library OPAC, search system, different kind of OER based tools, as Dr. Saha and Professor Waharara talked about. So this is all from my side. Anything else you are having?
Sir, one question. Sir, one from Sir, is integrity possible with Soul?
Definitely. If your backend service is available in a web-enabled architecture, so Soul is presently providing you an web OPAC. Soul 2 is providing, and Soul 3 will also be providing. So web OPAC is definitely possible to integrate. Anything you are having a URL kind of thing, it is possible to integrate.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. No more question here. Now, anyone can question from our organizer point of view? Anyone?
Please unmute yourself and you can question. Okay, check chat box. Okay, Abhijita, it may go for vote of thanks.
Now it is time for vote of thanks, and vote of thanks will be given our IQC coordinator, Dr. Kajol.
Abhijita, continue.
Professor Dev, please.
Okay.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir,
audible.
Honorable speakers, Professor Bulu Maharana, Professor Partho Sarathi Mukhopadhyay, Dr. Nimai Chand Saha, respected Principal Dr. Amitabh Bosu, and all the distinguished participants. Very good evening, everyone. Introduce myself. I am Kajol Krishna De, a member of the organizing committee of today's webinar. And as you know, our institution always remains engaged in different academic activities. Now in the present pandemic situation, when we are to keep ourselves away from each other due to an invisible enemy, this webinar is an attempt to bring us close to each other for a fruitful interaction, and which has also been clear from today's lecture. And I am happy that we have got overwhelming responses from even different neighboring countries. And I followed that at around 300 participants enjoyed till today's last lecture. Now, it's my proud privilege to be here on behalf of the organizing committee for the Thanksgiving ceremony. And so I, on behalf of BB College Asansol, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the distinguished speakers for gracing this occasion. A big thank you, sir, to Honorable Professor Bulu Maharana from Sambalpur University for your excellent deliberation on open access and scholarly communications implications in COVID-19 environment. We must mention our deep sense of appreciation and express our sincere thanks to Dr. Nimai Chand Saha from Vishwabharati University for giving enchanting and informative coverage on open educational resources for teaching learning current context. We also convey a big thank you, sir, to Professor Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay from Kollani University for enriching us through your excellent and illustrative lecture on virtual learning environment is the new normal, text and context. We also express our sincere thanks to Mr. Sujan Saha, librarian, CBCH, Jalpaiguri, for your great help extended to us by providing the virtual platform and hosting the today's webinar. We take this opportunity to extend our sincere thanks to all the participants for their enormous cooperation in making this webinar successful. Finally, we would like to pay our hearty thanks to our chief patron, Mr. Maloy Ghatak, Honorable Minister in Charge, Department of Labor, Government of West Bengal, and also the President of the Governing Body, BB College Asansol. I also express my sincere thanks to our principal, sir, Dr. Amitabh Basu, who is also the patron of today's webinar, for your guidance and constant support. We have been fortunate enough to have a team of motivated and dedicated colleagues. They are Mr. Abhijit Chakraborty, Dr. Snigdha Rai, Mr. Uddalak Datta, Ms. Amrita Mitra, and Dr. Amalendu Samanto. On behalf of our college and on behalf of myself, a big thank you to all of you. We thank you for being with us this evening. It has been a great pleasure to us. Thank you very much. Over to Sujan Shah.
Thank you, sir. Principal, sir. Hello.
Hello.
Sir. The meeting end. The meeting is ended here. You please declare that. Webinar is ended.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all our invited speakers, our participants, and the member of all our organizing committee. Really, a very enriching session. Hello. Am I audible?
Sir, continue.
Audible. Yes, sir. Continue. Continue, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much to all our participants. And it is really enriching and session for all of us. And I'm continuously reading the reading the chat from our participants. It is really excellent deliberation from all our speakers, and request from all the participants is coming that sharing their PPTs and materials. So from that feedback, we can realize that it is really enriching session and very much beneficial for all our participants and to us also. And thank you very much. And this webinar is closed.
And I am formally declared the end of this webinar for today. Thank you very much.